every person in America is either a doer or a don'ter. A doer or a don'ter. And if I can get you to learn one thing today, one take-home point, it would be this. Don't be a don'ter. Do be a doer.
Which one are you, Playboy?
Me?
No, someone else sitting in your seat. Come on, which one are you?
I'm a doer.
Is that a question?
I'm a doer.
What is this, Valentine's Day? Say it like you want to hunt it, skin it, and mount its head on your wall!
I'm a doer!
What?
I'm a doer! Yeah! I'm a doer!
Welcome to episode 35 of the Dealers Compress podcast. My name is Paul J. Daly, and as you can see, I will be hosting you today from the road, right out here outside these windows. It's downtown Chicago. I just finished the Hirology Elevate conference today. Had an awesome day today. Had an awesome networking reception last night. Actually had an awesome conversation today with Dale Pollack and his marketing team at V-Auto and the MX agency that V-Auto uses. Got some really cool stuff in the works. Top secret, can't tell you about it. And have a great guest today. So, you know, always trying to bring you variety on the show, always trying to bring you something maybe from an interesting perspective or something you haven't heard before. So today we have Kendall Griffin, who is the customer experience manager for the manufacturer Nissan. It's the first time we've had a manufacturer employee on the show, so I'm excited about that. Kendall has an interesting perspective. He's been in the business for almost 20 years. He did a long stint with Toyota, and you know what he does with Nissan now is kind of consider the customer experience from before they buy the car, through the buying process, the experience they have after, and he kind of takes all of that information and all of that feedback, and he helps dealers dial in the process to make them better. So it's just interesting hearing from another perspective. You know, I think we talk sometimes on the show about the natural tension between manufacturers and dealers, and it's kind of a built-in tension. So it was nice to hear from somebody and meet somebody from a manufacturer and just kind of get his vibe and his feel for really wanting to assist dealers to serve the customer better so that dealers can win. And so we're going to talk to him in just a minute. One thing that I've been thinking about a lot lately, and especially on this trip, is two words. There's go, and then there's do. I think it's kind of simple instructions, but the go part really represents getting out of your comfort zone and getting out of the routines that we find ourselves in that often we find ourselves just kind of locked into and kind of the victim of it sometimes, because the routine often is what paralyzes us. The familiar sometimes makes us shut our brain off. So it's not really open to new ideas. It's not really open to growth. Or maybe we think that we're done growing, or we have a reason to blame our stagnant nature on outside forces and everybody else and the government and your dad who, you know, wasn't nice to you and this one situation that happened. And going, like actually getting up and going somewhere different, especially somewhere that inspires you or around other people who are moving toward the same things that you want, going is something that moves you forward. And whenever I get to come out to a conference or I get to go with other like-minded people who have perspective of wanting to change, wanting to improve, wanting to be better, I find myself inspired to be better. And my head gets clear. I get outside the minutiae and just the day-in, day-out hustle of building a business and being, you know, a dad and serving in here and doing this and doing that. And I just get a little bit clear and I start to focus in on what is actually possible. And it's very freeing for me. So that's the first half is go. The second half is do. And now that I've gone and been inspired and kind of seen a little bit more clearly what the potential and possibilities are, well, now I have to do something about it. And lots of people just go and they never do. And they go again and they never do. And they go and they feel like, oh, you know, there was this mind-blowing event and I feel, and then they never do. And that's a problem. That's how you stay stuck. And, you know, one thing that bothers me sometimes is when I see people who are talented and capable they treat these experiences of going as the ultimate thing. They're like, well, if I just go, that somehow makes me different or makes my life different. And that's just a bunch of crap. It's not true. And then they come down off the high, and then so they have to book the next trip. So they go again, and still nothing changes. Why? Because you didn't do. So there's the go and the do. I tend to think that going and doing, like, you don't need to go again. You just need to do and execute to the knowledge and the talent and the experience that you already have. So go and do is just something I've been thinking a lot about today and a lot recently. And I'm going to try to share some of the goes, some of the places I'm going over the next few months, some of the things that I'm doing as a result of those. I also want to share those with you. I hope this encourages you and inspires you to go. It doesn't have to be far either. It doesn't have to be Chicago or like a plane trip away. It could just be the cafe or the coffee house. You know, if your regular routine has you in the house all day and maybe you have kids and has you in the house with kids all day, go somewhere quiet. Go to a Starbucks. You know, actually have a latte and have a minute to yourself. Sometimes that going is all you need to be inspired. Listen to some music that you love. But then don't stop. Then do. Go. Do. I hope you enjoy our guest. That was a weird segue. It's late. It's like, holy crap. It's 11:15 here, which means it's after midnight my time. We'll just do that again. I'm going to crash hard after this. So back to our guest, Kendall Griffin. I hope you enjoy him. I hope you enjoy his message. And just enjoy hearing from somebody else in the industry that you most likely would have never met. Enjoy it.
So, Kendall, thank you so much for spending a little time with us today.
Absolutely.
I know you got a lot going on out there. I think it's so great for our dealers and the people that watch and listen to the podcast to hear from what I would consider a really unique perspective.
Okay.
You're in the car business, but you're not necessarily a car guy. So why don't you just, like, what is it from your perspective? What do you do?
So I currently work for Nissan as the customer experience manager, and that entails all the customer touch points, from digital to actually the customer walking into the store and shaking hands with the sales consultant. What we want to make sure is that the sales consultants and the dealership team have the tools necessary to not only complete that transaction at that time, but also retain the customer in the future and service them for all their car buying needs.
So I think one of the things that's interesting is that the dealers and the general managers and the sales managers and right down the chain, the salespeople, right, they probably often, you know, have to implement or are the ones, the layer that implements changes that in some way, shape, or form started off at your level, you know, based on some feedback you got. So from that perspective, mm-hmm. what is the level of communication you have with the dealers on the dealer level?
Well,
I don't know how many layers, so maybe if you could just quickly explain the structure.
Yeah, so I run the department, but actually a lot of the information is disseminated down through our field team, mm-hmm. and usually that's where the contact happens, is with our field team and the dealership. In my role, though, I also travel out to the dealerships mm-hmm. to do some one-on-one communication as well. Mm-hmm. So.
And how long have you been doing this type of work?
I've been in the automotive business since 2000.
Okay.
In my current role, I actually just started in this current role about a week and a half ago. So.
Okay. What were you doing before this role?
So before this role, I was with Toyota for 17 years in various different roles in the field. And the latest role when I was with Toyota was as the facility business management manager.
Gotcha.
So a lot of automotive experience.
No doubt.
Yeah,
no doubt.
Absolutely.
You're at the Hireology Elevate Human Capital Management Strategy. I can't. It's a really long name. Sometimes I get
yes,
it wrong.
Yes.
But we're learning about the people side of the business.
Absolutely.
Why are you here when you're in the customer experience side? Why are you at this event today?
Well, one, I think most importantly is you should never stop learning. Mm-hmm. And any insights that I can take from this conference and relay back to our field team, which relays it to our dealerships, I think is a positive. Mm-hmm. And the people side of this business is so important. One of the stats that I look at is turnover in our sales department is over 70%, mm-hmm. you know, which is lost productivity, mm-hmm. lost profit for our dealers, lost efficiency, and usually translate into not so good experience for our consumers. Mm-hmm. So any way we can limit that by taking a look at our human capital mm-hmm. and making that process better, I think is a win for everyone.
Yeah, that's actually a really holistic approach, which is part of the solution, the fact that you tie back, hey, turnover is really bad for the customer experience.
Absolutely.
And that's not something, you know, one of the things that we talk about a lot is that it's tough for CFOs and mm-hmm. dealer principals to, you know, approve an investment in branding, mm-hmm. improve an investment in HR, in a sense where it's the long view and the long vision, because you can't immediately measure it on a balance sheet or a P&L. So that point just drives that home, is that fact that you're paying attention to turnover mm-hmm. in the sense that, like, hey, people that aren't turning over as faster, that stay longer, know the business better, they're more educated about the product, they understand the initiatives that you're taking to try to give a better, more, you know, more smooth customer experience.
Absolutely. It's kind of getting out of that 30-day cycle and looking at, you know, when you say looking at the business holistically or long term, you want to invest in your people so that they're happy and stand around. And if you've got a happy employee, you've got a happy customer. Mm-hmm. So that's what it's all about, is, you know, making sure you're taking care of your people so that they're taking care of your consumers.
Well, what is one thing that you've really been noticing? You pay a lot of attention to the customer behaviors, mm-hmm. right? And a lot of the feedback that you get, not only when they're considering a brand and during the process, but also like how they feel after the process.
Yeah.
And you know what you could have done to make it better. What is kind of like number one with a bullet? Like, what is the problem that you're trying to address or solve right now? As specific as possible, you know?
I think the one thing, and I think it's an industry-wide thing, is that the consumer has access to a lot more information.
Yeah.
You know, they have a lot of times they come in more educated than a lot of our sales associates. Mm-hmm. So it's just making sure that we're being transparent and upfront so that we can help facilitate the process. Like I said, the consumers, you know, they've got supercomputers in their pockets. So it's right. Nothing that they don't know anymore. It's no information that they don't have. So it's just making sure that we're making it, you know, being as efficient as we can and as transparent as we can to facilitate the car buying experience.
Give me an example of a situation where you know the customer has the information, mm-hmm. right? As some, we would say this is an efficient marketplace.
Right.
Customers have the same information as the dealers.
Right.
Hasn't been that way. Certainly wasn't that way when you started in 2000.
Absolutely.
Right? So what happens when the dealer behaves in a way as if ignoring the fact that the customer has all the information? How does that break down?
Yeah, well, I mean, in those situations, which we hope those situations don't happen, but in that event, I think immediately when the dealer assumes that a customer doesn't have the information, they lose credibility. Mm-hmm. And even if the customer goes through with the sale or the transaction, whether it's service or sales, usually it leaves them with a bad taste in their mouth. Mm-hmm. And then with social media now, I mean, you know, it only takes a couple clicks of the keyboard before the world knows about that information. Mm-hmm. So it's just making sure that we're being as transparent as possible and as upfront as possible so that we don't run into those situations. Mm-hmm. So
that's good insight. Yeah. I have a couple other questions, and these might seem a little off topic at first, but
okay.
So you seem like a pretty positive guy. I mean, we've only known each other for probably 24 hours, almost 24 hours.
Absolutely.
At this point. Maybe this is deeper than you expected to get.
Okay.
What do you want people to say about you in your professional career? Like, when you're done, or when you wrap, or you know, you left Toyota,
yeah.
right, and you're kind of taking another step in your career, at some point you might leave Nissan, but maybe never Nissan.
Maybe never.
Lifer. It's up to you, Nissan. So what do you want people to say about you? Like, what do you want that legacy to be in the automotive industry?
Absolutely. I think first and foremost that he's a hard worker, that he wasn't afraid to roll up his sleeves and get the job done. But I think secondly, you know, that he was thoughtful, that he looked for creative solutions to problems. Mm-hmm. I would say those would be the two top things. And yeah, just wanted to leave my mark as one that being a person that was a change agent that kind of looked at things and always thought, hey, how can we tweak this to make it better?
That's really cool.
Yeah, absolutely.
Give me an example of how you see the variety of like the dealers who are responding well to the current change that we have going mm-hmm. on, speaking about change, and the ones that are having a hard time with it. What's the variable between the two?
I think the variable between the two in general, and not speaking about any brand, just looking at, you know, the overall automotive industry, the people that are focused or the dealers that are focused on people now mm-hmm. are winning.
So people first thinking.
Because when you focus on people, I think that brings profit, that brings retention, that brings all the other things that you're looking for. So I would say definitely the dealers, the manufacturers that are focused on their people mm-hmm. and developing their people and wanting their people to grow are definitely going to be the winners when you look at the future. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
What drives you personally? So it's like a personal non-Nissan hat question. What drives you personally to like engage this job? What drives you personally to just like, why do you want to do this kind of work?
Yeah, I think what personally drives me is probably my faith, my family, my friends. I feel like I'm a people person. So, you know, when I'm around people with energy, I kind of feed off mm-hmm. of that energy. Those are, you know, kind of, if I have my top four things that drive me, I would say those would be the top four.
Kind of final question.
Yeah.
What do you think of the Philadelphia Eagles?
The Eagles, I'm a Chicago guy,
so unless there's a Super Bowl involved, we don't have any beef.
I'm absolutely focused on the Bears. We just had a big win this last Sunday. We got a bye this coming Sunday, but looking forward to 2 weeks from now. As far as the Eagles, I mean, you guys got your quarterback back.
Did.
So, you know, I wish you guys luck until...
Not like we needed him to beat the Patriots,
yeah, yeah,
but...
I wish you guys luck until we get to the Super Bowl.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll take that.
Absolutely.
No, thanks so much for your time today. I look forward to share it with the audience and the dealers, and best of luck to you at Nissan.
Appreciate it. This was great.
Thanks.
All right. Take care.
So that's our interview today. I hope you liked it. I hope you learned something from it. At the very, 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 very least, I hope it broadened your horizons and perspective, because it's someone that you never met and you didn't know. And that's how we learn and we grow, by listening to people and learning about their experiences and then overlaying them into what we have to do next. So to remind, go, do. Thank you for being a part of this version of Going and Doing. I hope to bring you more in the future. Please reach out, as always, if you need anything, and got a lot more stuff coming up. Glad that you're part of the journey. Thank you. Have a great day. Man, these endings are terrible lately. Have a great day. It's midnight. I'm out.
I'm a dog!